ourselves as in Taj Bengal and Shree Cements. It gives me great honor and privilege to welcome Ms. Neelima Dalmia Adhar today, who is best described as a people watcher, drawn towards oddities and thrives on writing about people and personalities from the quirky to the bizarre. And in conversation with her, we have Ms. Supriya Newar, who for the last 18 years has keenly traversed the complete spectrum of brand and communication, a music aficionado, an avid traveler, and a bookworm herself. She also is a visiting lecturer at various institutes where young minds are being formed, and she's also serving as the non-executive director in the board of LinkedIn. So ladies, may I welcome you on stage this afternoon for the conversation. Ladies and gentlemen, let's look forward to a lovely conversation.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's an absolute pleasure to be here to welcome all of you and to welcome Mrs. Neelima Dalmia Adhar. One of the first difficulties I had when we were chatting up a couple of days ago is how should I address her, because, you know, believe it or not, she's a grandmother of two children. But she put my difficulties to rest and she said, I'm Neelima. So, hi Neelima, welcome to Calcutta.
Thank you.
And to Taj, lovely to have you here. You've been a teacher of psychology at the Delhi University. How did writing happen then?
I'm a writer partly by default and partly by my legacy from my mother. My mother, Dinesh Anthony Dalmia, was a Hindi writer who was given the Padma Bhushan the year she died in 2006. And she had over 40 books published in both poetry and prose. She started writing at the age of 12, and she was the first woman graduate of Rajasthan. She was given the title of Rajasthan Meera because most of her writing was like love odes in the voice of Meera to Krishna. So in a sense, she was an expert on Shringar and on love and on Meera and Krishna. And as a child, I remember when she used to write, well, not as a child, but later years, that I used to often edit her work. She had this awful scroll and nobody could read it. So I used to copy her work for her and edit it for her before she submitted it. And I think partly it was that which kind of filtered into me,
sure. And
made me the writer that I was to be. Although she often told me, likho, likho, she used to constantly say you should write on your father was always her thing. But writing came to me much later. It was in 2002 that my first book was published.
So let me try and explain or at least expound on the last comment which you just made. In the diary, the secret diary of Kasturba, I read it all of last week, and I must say, I was telling her as much, that it was a hard read, a difficult read, because irrespective of whatever your political like or dislike is for the father of the nation, but the father, the biological father that he is to his eldest son, Harilal, took me. It brings tears to your eyes because he really suffered being Gandhi's son, didn't he? And how hard was it to actually write it out and, see his downfall?
Actually, writing about myself was easy. And writing about Harilal was easier.
Okay.
Because it was like I was just revisiting that.
That's psychology playing out.
That's psychology playing out. And I pretty much, I think I entered the souls of these characters, like the soul of Kasturba Gandhi, to be able to write about her. And then I made it into her voice and created it like a diary rather than, do a linear narrative of just from womb to tomb. I wanted to get into the folds of that trauma, the conflict she had in her mind. The ability to be able to deal with the ordinariness of the extraordinary man that she married. So she was living with Mohandas. She wasn't living with the Mahatma. And in all such iconic figures, just like my father's life, the first casualty of that ordinariness is the wife and children.
Sure.
So in a way, I lived Kasturba. I spoke her voice. I lived Harilal. I emoted with him very deeply. It was very easy to write that because I had already written it. So much so that I often used to read out excerpts of my book to my children, my son and my daughter, who was 35 and 30. And my son said to me that, you know, this book, the second one, the first book on my father's called Father Dearest. And he said, you could well title this book Mother Dearest. So it was such a strong parallel resonance with my mother's story. I could almost feel that it was just a change of name. It was that, you know, underlying feeling of being alienated by the Marwaris, by my mother. And she always had this dream that my daughter should marry. The only way to get revenge and finally vindicate herself is that at least one of her daughters should get married to some great business house of Calcutta, which unfortunately or fortunately never happened. So yes, I wanted to say that there is that underlying angst, because I felt that I'm proud of my Marwari lineage. I'm very happy to be who I am. I don't want to ever be born anything else but a Marwari.
That goes for the two of us.
But all the same, I felt that there's too much hypocrisy in the clan.
I agree.
And as an insider, I have a right to expose that hypocrisy.
And what better way than to change things from the inside instead of being dictated from the outside on what to do and how to change it?
You know, Supriya used to write a blog on my Facebook, which was, it was a bit of a flippant kind of 150-200 word blog every day. And I used to just write a little kind of a, what should I say, satire on the night before any party I had been. And I had this cute little thing of lampooning the Marwaris. So some friends of mine...
You're beginning, I'm sorry to interrupt, you're beginning to behave like Gandhi, is hardest on his own son. You seem to be hardest on your own community.
Not at all. I love and adore being who I am. And so one of my friends, who's a Marwari, who's relocated to Delhi, and she said that, so why do you mix with us so much if you hate us so much? And I said, you got it all wrong. I don't. I love being who I am.
Sure.
And so I'm only complaining about my own clan. I have a right to do that.
Absolutely.
So anyway, on the more serious side, yes, there was an angst about them. And I felt that there's a duplicity in Marwari lives. They're very pious on the outside. I pardon any offense that I may be causing to the present company here. But like I said, I'm saying it about myself.
Sure.
And I lived with a man who had enormous duplicity. My father. So I think I have a foothold into that, and I have a right to speak about it.
How do people, what is it that would first catch your attention?
Certainly not the ordinary and the saintly. It's the wicked and the bizarre, because that is what draws me in.
But people are good at hiding the wicked sides, no?
Yeah, I'm not saying I'm the best judge of it, but definitely I'm drawn to bizarre things. I think part of that I could blame on my own childhood, because we had a bizarre childhood. Mm-hmm. I don't remember anybody in my peer group or around me or my society who had a home in which there were four stepmothers and 18 siblings and a father who was sent to jail when I was in class 8. And so I think I'm
bizarre.
Bizarre
all the way. I also have to ask you that the number of hats that you wear today, right? Of course, you're here in that capacity today. Parent, grandparent, you're socially active. What are the other plumes of the hat that we must know about?
Actually, you're being very kind to me. There are no plumes. But I have to say that the core personality that I very preciously guard is being a mother and a grandma. My children are my best friends, my best critics, the filters to who I am today, the way I dress, the way I talk. I give them total credit for who I am, much more than my parents, my children have shaped me. And I'm surrounded by youngsters.
Lovely.
I think that's the reason why I can claim to be young, and anybody who asks me my age, because whenever I go out with my daughter, everybody says like she's your didi, and so my daughter of course feels, and my granddaughter says, Nani, mom never likes to go out with you because everybody thinks you're a Masi.
Yeah.
So, yes, but I hold them very close to my heart, and they are my best friends. Other than that, the kind hats that you've given me, I enjoy being with people. My passion indeed is people watching. I can I've made hundreds of mistakes, I'm not the best at it, but I enjoy doing it. And when I do discover that somebody is not what I had imagined them to be, then it breaks my heart. Because I just fall in love with everybody who falls in love with me.
Some of the finest poetry in the world in all languages has been caught there.
And I don't know if I'll really do it, but I have often thought on writing a book in the voice of death.
Mm-hmm. Sounds fascinating.
I don't know if I'll be able to do
it. You play death the narrator.
I play death the narrator. Yeah.
That's something to watch out, inshallah. And we can think of some corny titles for that in Hindi. Maut ki awaaz or something.
I'm sure it'll have more gravitas than that.
Right. I have to ask you that since you say that you're not a full-time writer, what is the discipline of writing? Did you have a routine? How would you go about it? How was the research for all the books? And did you finally arrive upon a set pattern, or would it happen when inspiration came to you?
See, it was different for all the three books. For Father Dearest, I wrote this book in 9 months. With the 1 month
gap. That's less time than the fetus.
That's less time than the fetus.
Yeah.
The first part of the book, which surprised me myself, is because when a friend of mine had told me to write this biography on my father, I said, I don't know how to write. How do you want me to write it? I don't know how to write. And that also on Arkidamya, I'll be like a dwarf. What will I write? So much has been written about him. And she said a very strange, prescient thing. And she said that, I don't know about any other book, but I know you can do this book. And she said, just go back home and start writing. Take a diary and start writing. And that's exactly what I did. When I put my pen down, the first time when I started writing that book, I had written 1/3 of the book.
Wow. Okay.
So at that time, there was no discipline. I didn't believe I was a writer. I was just taking a shot at it.
We've seen movies and documentaries made on Gandhi. I won't be surprised if somebody picks up this book and says that, listen, we need to film Kasturba.
I think...
would you allow that?
Oh, I would love that. That would be the culmination of my...
Who do you think should play Kasturba?
Any day with your wife.
Oh, wow.
Any day. She'll do a fantastic job.
And who's going to play Gandhi? It doesn't matter. We are going to be booted out very soon.
No, it doesn't matter. Coming back to this story, I have to tell you, that...
Yeah, catch a flight and run away. I have to be here.
No, I won't. That's not me. Agent provocative. No, because in the last 1.5 years, when I really got into the crux of the book, I would say, and I finished it in those years, so I wasn't seeing my friends too much, and every time, no, I can't, I'm writing, I'm not free. So one friend of mine, she sent me a note saying, can we meet Neelima now? When can we meet Neelima? But the sweetest
bar, of course, is Kasturba. So
exactly. Yeah. But the two things which I'll carry with me to my grave is that one of the sweet followers on Twitter sent me a note saying that I read your book, and we would like to see the day when instead of Bapu we have Ba on the currency note. And the even smarter thing, which again I will carry for the rest of my life, is that at the Delhi book launch, Shashi Tharoor was launching the book, and we were having this heated discussion about Gandhi's sex life and whether it was justified or not, and what was the victim wife and blah blah blah. And he said he was being very diplomatic, put an end to it. And he said, so in one word, we should sum it up and we should say that Neelima has given Kasturba an Adhar card.
I think that's
the smartest. That's
the smartest thing to say. Yeah, absolutely. So, Neelima, what has writing come to mean to you now that it's organized writing, it's not a blog, it's not flipping, your books have been, especially the last one, has been hugely accepted, appreciated, you've done launches across. What has it come to mean to you now?
Writing is my soul. Without writing, actually, I have transformed as a person after I began writing, and I would have been really sorry. I think it was destiny. I'm very fatalistic. I was meant to be a writer, but had I not written, I would have gone to my grave a very unfulfilled person.
Not a found person.
Exactly. I rooted myself. My axis is my writing. My personality, I think, reflects it. I would not want to be perceived as anything other than a writer.
Lovely. That's lovely. To go through your own journey and to be able to find yourself.
Much by fluke though, but yes.
That's fine. Most of us are, you know, shooting arrows out here and there to see which one, you know, strikes home. So that's lovely. Are there any particular memories or incidents or any kind of mental trauma that you went through? Because you were also writing about the father of the nation and his life and ripping it apart. Was it difficult at any stage for you?
No. No, it wasn't difficult, but I will be lying if I say that I wasn't brutalized by the story. Because Gandhi's, the cruel father that he was, and the tyrannical husband that he was, again, it was like reliving the life that I had lived. There is an incident in this book which has particularly touched me. In fact, there are two, and I still, you know, choke up when I talk about it. One was the one where the second son, Devdas, is no Manilal, is 20 years old, and they're in Africa. And he is infatuated by one of the young girls of the ashram in Mits, the Tolstoy farm. And they're all playing in the pool and by the river. They had this recreation time, and so he and this girl developed this kind of affinity, and they're like close and intimate with each other. And one day while he's in the pool, in the river, he mistakes that girl, who's Lalita, for another one of the inmate's daughters, and he kind of touches her hair. That girl has beautiful long dark hair. And that girl sort of comes out, surfaces, and she's appalled because she's seen him with the other girl, and she says, she goes to Bapu and she complains about
it. And it's a mistake.
He's not trying to grab that other girl. He just mistakes her for the girl that he thinks is his.
What do you read as a writer?
I do. And I don't read as much as I should or as much as I appear to. But yes, I read. By discipline, I read one book a month.
Okay.
I just finished reading that, A Man Called Ove. It's a book written by a Swedish writer, translated into English. Very nice, happy, light read before that. So I'm not particular about, I like reading about personalities. I like reading about
particular biographies or
not really. But my all-time, what should I say, icon of authors is Ayn Rand.
Howard Roark.
I always dreamt of meeting and marrying Howard Roark. Yes. But, So I read anything and everything. I've read recently The Light That We Cannot See, a book on the Second World War, which is about, I've read a few books. I've read Spy Princess. So I just read whichever's, you know, thrown up as the bestseller book of the month. And if they interest me, I read them. Some I bought, let's read them. So that's good.
Shall we take some questions?